Francis Marsh, better known to his friends and family as Bob. I know him as Grandpa. I'd like to thank everyone who's here, family, friends, loved ones, neighbors. We're so grateful that you could spend some time with us to remember and to honor and appreciate him and his memory. We'll begin by a performance of his favorite song, Ave Maria, by his grandson, Aaron Marsh. Hear the eulogy from his son, Mark Marsh.
Well, I want to thank you all for coming. A lot of us knew him many different ways. And while Dad's passing was not unexpected, it still shocked me. We're here to celebrate and share how Robert Marsh lived his life. He was a wonderful family man, devoted husband, and defender of our great country. He lived a long, adventuresome life, exploring the globe with his bride, Maria. Starting in humble beginnings with five other siblings, born of two bakers. He joined the army during the Korean conflict, but quickly was assigned to Germany. There he met Mom, and his course was set for the next 67 years. The army sent him to Germany and Kansas and Hawaii, Pennsylvania, and Korea, and California, Vietnam, back to Germany, Louisiana, back to Germany, back to California. My folks decided to settle down here in San Diego, where I was with my family in 1984. It was only the second house they ever owned, and they worked hard to make it a family oasis. He changed as the years went on. Korea and Vietnam changed him. He became gentler, quieter, said more I love yous, really expressed a quiet dignity. Dad was a great organizer and saver. As I was going through his office, I found the bill for my birth. It was, I believe, $1.98. It was at an army hospital. I don't know, they must have given you some more aspirin or something. He said that they were savers. Again, inside, kept a lot inside. Now, I don't know if that's the Bob that you know. Because, like I said, as the years went on, he became over here more outgoing, I think, to certain people. You know, he always had a smile, always heading up to the mailbox, right? Stop in and chat with all the neighbors. I'm going to say a few things as I go through of things he's always said to me. Biggest one was, I'd rather owe it to you than cheat you out of it. So as we moved on in life, and he was always trying to share, but made sure that you knew how to do things yourself too. I remember his love of baseball. Unfortunately, he had to come to grips with my 0.71 batting average. He'd say, "Oh, Mark, another pack of baseball cards. Let's go see if Yaz is in there." Loved going through the cards with us. The folks saved and saved so they'd be able to give their children a start in life and enjoy their own golden years. And they did enjoy them. They cruised and took pilgrimages, visiting St. Petersburg, Vienna, China, Costa Rica, Peru, South Africa, I believe, the Holy Land, Lourdes, India, New Zealand, Alaska, Hawaii, Tucson, Arizona. He used to tell me, "Mark, whatever Mom wants, get it for her. We try." He loved going to the lake, or a beach, or barbecuing steaks, smoking salmon. And he had the occasional stogie early on. He loved family get-togethers, throwing the ball around, always giving me that little glare when I threw it over his head. Say to me, "Mark, don't make a fuss, take care of me." The last few years were a little rough. He had physical limitations he had never had before. He kept on so he could be with Mom. He told all of us of stories we hadn't heard before about his military service and the ball games and all the fun things that he went with, and more reminiscing about the great times we had. This is the first time that the whole family's been together. He only learned about little watch on Thursday. But he would be proud of his family. Before us is his mortal shell. But the gift he gave to all of us is in our own hearts and in our minds. I love you, Dad. And we're going to miss not being able to make new memories with them. So we just have to cherish the ones that we can. Oh, let me read one more thing. Sorry. So Dad read from his, it's not a prayer book, it's a devotion book. And on June 28th, today, is, if God has given you some special work to do that frightens you, it's your responsibility to jump at it. It's up to the Lord to see you through. As you faithfully do your part, he will do his part. And that is exactly how Dad taught us to live.
We're now going to open up the time if anyone would like to come forward and share a special memory or sentiment that they have for Bob.
Hi, I'm Aaron from earlier. I'm the grandson. And what's interesting about, like, all of this week to me hasn't just been about, like, the amount of sadness there is in loss, but, like, the amount of beauty that his life has really been all the way through. Like, I was, like, thinking about all these things. I'm like, I'm never going to see a 67-year-long marriage ever again. You know, I'm only going to see one. And that was his. That's, like, that's my only comparison of that. And I got to watch that for the 40 years I was allowed to. You know, and also the idea that, like, if somewhere there was a guardian angel in the beginning of my life, it's like, here's your grandpa. You're going to have him for 40 years. I'd be like, that's amazing. You know, and they're like, is having an amazing time with him at the end, does it make it easier? And like, well, no, that's the bad part. It doesn't, you know, like, but you still get all of that time. You know, like, and he, like, I talked to him on Monday, and I remember, like, him being sick. And that's when I was like, oh no, he answered the phone when he's sick. You know, like, he wouldn't have done that. And I was like, and I was asking how he was feeling, and he was like, oh, we're going to get through, you know, like, but it was also like, let's not make any plans. Cause I was immediately like, should we come over, you know, like, and he was always thinking about us. He was always making friends with everybody he ever met, which was incredible. You know, like, to the point that when he would hang out in his backyard, he made friends with the animals in the neighborhood and they'd come visit him. I'd never, like, that's the closest to Snow White I've met in a human being. Because he'd be like, oh, yeah, that's my friend. I feed him up to, oh, it's 1:30. He's waiting. You know, like, he must be hungry. Like, he knew every animal. And then he also knew where their house was on the hill, which I still don't know how he knows those facts. Like, my memory as a grandchild is every time, like, a Ralph's truck would drive past us, he'd tell us what was on the truck. And it didn't hit me till I was, like, 29 that he was making it up. Because he was like, oh, no, you can see it. There are the little words right there. And, like, it drove really fast past us. I don't know how you know. And then I was like, why did all of them have Ovaltine? And I was like, oh, he was playing with us the entire time. He was so sly with his humor that I didn't realize he was funny until I was a teenager. And then there was like, I remember I asked my dad, I was like, when did Grandpa get funny? He's like, he's always been funny. You're just now smart enough to get. He would slide him past us. In fact, my most embarrassing memory of my own childhood was with him, where I bought a book from school for like $1, an address book. I remember a kid in the neighborhood was like, you wouldn't dare write in that. And I was like, yes, I would. You know, like, I had to show him. And so I wrote down his phone number and his address. And I was like, give it to him on Christmas. He'll find it days later. It will never be discovered. And on Christmas morning, he opened it up. I swear to that exact page. And went, who's Zyda? You know, I was like, and he was like, well, I'll call him and find out. You know, like, that was. And then years later, I was like, that's really funny and quick to get all of that happening at once, where it clearly could have been like, hey, this is not to do with someone's present. You know, like, which is really where I learned more about, like, what I was doing to prove to the kid wasn't about, like, the damage wasn't towards the kid, it was towards the respect of him and his stuff, which never was anything I would do again. You know, like, there's drawers in his house I haven't even touched because there's no permission. You know, like, it's gonna be that way forever. But it is really beautiful that the last couple of years, I feel like he took every call toward before and be like, I'll call you back. He also taught me, I remember calling him like 10 years ago, and I was drinking some water. And when I answered, he said, hello, and I was like trying to swallow it, and he just hung up. You know, like, he thought I was a solicitor. And so I also knew every time I called him to be prepared to say hello immediately. I wasn't going to let that happen to you. It is really cool because he didn't just talk to me about how much he loved, like, me. He talked to me about how much he loved you guys and Grandma. And I wanted to ask her, like, did you hear all the nice things? He said, like, she was right there. He told her, too. Like, there's no lack of communication for the amount of love that he had for us. I think that's what I have. Guys, thank you very much.
For those of you who don't know me, my name is Karen, and Bob is my father-in-law. From our first meeting over 25 years ago, I knew we would get along. We share a love of sports, any and all kinds. We never had a shortage of things to talk about. It was either baseball, football, or hockey season, or a season was just about to start. Dad was very supportive when the Cubs won the World Series in 2016, but he always reminded me that the Cubs had a lot of work to do if they were to be like his Boston Red Sox. If we weren't talking about sports, Dad was making me laugh. His wry sense of humor was second to none. I learned early on that if you don't pay close attention, you might miss one of his jokes. So, my name's Marie. And I'm one of his granddaughters. So, I just wrote a little something. So
So, my grandpa was a very special one, as we all know. He had a contagious smile that could soften a heart instantly. I'm really gonna miss his smile. I really loved it. He was witty, and as everyone said, he was really quick with the comebacks. Sometimes he'd say something and we'd just say, Grandpa, or oh my gosh, Grandpa. I really loved that he laughed at his own jokes. He was also incredibly humble with all his accomplishments and all that he's seen, traveled to, or been through. He never did boast, ever. So much stuff I still don't even know because he was just so humble about everything. He really did love us grandkids and touched all our hearts in different ways. He was... He was the kind of grandpa that never missed birthdays and would sneak you some money when you left his house. Although, he didn't really sneak me money, he stuck it to my husband. And he would tell him stuff that I still don't know. They have secrets. I try to get some out, but he just won't tell me. So I'm not sure what they had going on. Something special, though. I'll really miss his hugs and his sweet kisses on the cheeks. They're always so aggressive. He'd just grab me and just kiss me, like almost sometimes on the lips. I'm like, Grandpa. Goodbyes were really hard for him. Every time we leave the house, he'd become teary-eyed. And it really made our hearts ache. His heart was made of gold. I will also miss the way that he watched my daughters, his great-granddaughters. He was a great-grandpa. A great-grandpa. It's incredible. The last picture I took of my grandpa was him cheersing my daughter, Ella. He had a little sippy cup, and she had a milk. And they were cheersing. But he didn't just love us all. He served as an example to us all with how much he cared for and loved my grandma. One time I even caught them taking a nap together and they were holding hands. They had something very rare and special and they lived a real life love story. And once in a while he'd remind us that you have to fight for each other. The memories I have with my grandpa I'll cherish forever. And I'm so grateful to have had such a loving grandpa that, and I had the privilege of being one of his grandkids. I do know that his spirit does live, and we're going to love and miss grandpa so much. But I do believe, and I have high hopes, that one day we will be reunited, one way or another. I really do believe that. So thank you, Grandpa. And for your existence and your life. And the love that you leave with all of us.
My name is Carl Boudreaux. One of Bob's neighbors. There's several of us from the neighborhood that are here. Several of us in the neighborhood are retired military. Because we're in San Diego, most of us are Navy. When Bob moved into the neighborhood, we went to meet him. You know, we found out he was Army. But that didn't make a difference. He was the family. We're glad to see that he had a wonderful family. Although I lived in the neighborhood, I didn't get to meet many of you. But Bob, Bob was well liked in the neighborhood. Those of us that were really close with him, like you heard earlier, we'd meet him going to the mailbox, talking with him, sharing a funny story or two. Like he said, talking about sports, you know. One thing I really, my wife and I miss about Bob and me is we'd have him over for Thanksgiving or Christmas dinner. And he'd always, you know, made us feel at home in the neighborhood. I'll never be able to match his record for traveling, but he helped Carla and I on several of our cruises with Princess Cruise. So I have that memory. Although we never cruised with him, him and Marie showed us the way. So, with that, I think that's how I'm going to remember Bob. We're going to miss him in the neighborhood.
Hope we got everyone. If not, we look forward to hearing your memories another time. So, you've heard Grandpa was about Christian. So I wanted to share a thought with you about that. Jesus wept. This is one of the first scriptures a lot of us memorize because it's only two words. It's an easy one, and it's one that the youth especially like to memorize. Well, let me tell you the context behind that. So Jesus was traveling with his disciples and a good friend of his, Lazarus. He was really sick, so much so that his sisters, Mary and Martha, sent messengers. Because they knew Jesus. They had seen him perform miracles. They said, "We know you love Lazarus, and you really need to get here, because we know if you come, he'll be well." And then, to the surprise of probably everyone, Jesus said, "We're going to stay right where we are for a while." And a few days pass, and Jesus tells his disciples, he says, "Lazarus is sleeping now." And they said, "Well, if he's sick, it's good that he's resting. You know, he needs that." And he says, no, you must understand. He's dead now. And now it's time for us to get going." So it takes a few days' journey to get back to Bethany where he was. And this is significant because at this point 3 days have passed, and according to Jewish tradition, that's when the soul leaves the body. He gets there. He hasn't even gotten into town yet, and Mary finds him. And she says, "If you had been here, he would have been okay." "Nevertheless, I know that we'll see him again." And Jesus reiterates to that. He will be alive again. And she says, "I know, the resurrection, last days." She doesn't know the whole story yet. They keep going. They get to the house. Martha's there. And she says, "If you had been here," and he's like, "I know, we heard." But he says, "Yeah, he will live again." And this is where Jesus wept. Just think about that. The Son of God, he had performed miracles. He had raised the dead before. And he knew what was happening. But he took the time to mourn those that were mourning. He took the time to feel and process those emotions. We talk about the five stages of grief. And it's not a linear progression. It's not like you have one or two days of one and then move on to two or three or four. It's however you're feeling, whenever you feel it. Just denial, just anger, bargaining, depression, acceptance. Although in this case, we could call it rejoicing. And knowing that the frailties of life, the illness, the injuries will no longer impact him. That he's safe, and he is happy, and he is home, and he is surrounded by loved ones. And he knows we're here. And it's okay, whatever you're feeling. And so after Jesus had wept, he went to the cave and called out, Lazarus. And out he comes. And the Savior, the master of life and death, had called back the dead. And we know that later in Calvary, that he did the same for himself, that each of us will do likewise, that in the flesh and bone, we will see our Savior and Redeemer, that every single parting is temporary. And we know this, and Grandpa knew this. But the author Terry Pratchett said that a man is not dead while his name is still spoken. He was an avowed atheist, but he knew the power of sharing those memories and sharing those stories. Love Grandpa. He was a good guy. We had the privilege of getting to talk to him again, Father's Day call. Just for a few minutes, because that's what it usually was with Grandpa. You would say, Happy Father's Day. And he'd say, Thanks, you want to talk to your grandma? Logan and I got to wish him a Happy Father's Day one last time, just a few days before he passed. He was lucid, he was aware. He didn't hand the phone off right to Grandma. He spoke for like a minute or two. Which for him was a bit of a record. We love you and he loved you. And I know that I'll see him again and I'll hug him again. But I'll still weep. In the name of Jesus Christ. I'm going to have a song. I Need Thee Every Hour, performed by his daughter-in-law, or granddaughter-in-law, Danielle Marsh. Thank you. Shared, and now I'm gonna watch a short video that my brother Chris put together.
Shadows are falling, and I'm running out of breath. Keep me in your heart for a while. If I leave you, it doesn't mean I love you any less. Keep me in your heart for a while. When you get up in the morning and you see that crazy sun, keep me in your heart for a while. There's a train leaving nightly called when all is said and done. Keep me in your heart for a while. Sha la 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 la. Keep me in your heart for a while. Sha la 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 la. Keep me in your heart for a while. Sometimes when you're doing simple things around the house, maybe you'll think of me and smile. You know I'm tied to you like the buttons on your blouse. Keep me in your heart for a while. Hold me in your thoughts, take me to your dreams, touch me as I'm falling. Headed north to Pleasant Stream. Keep me in your heart for a while. These wheels keep turning, but they're running out of steam. cha la 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 la. Keep me in your heart for a while.
That concludes our program.
For those joining us for at Miramar, they want us in lane number one, right?